I am speaking with Holley Mangold, Olympic superstar and super stud. The fact that you finished, I think it fits. The fact that you completed your lifts with a torn tendon is incredible. I mean, it's just like, it's so inspirational. You can see it being a movie someday.
Yeah, I mean, it was super painful and crazy, but it was kind of one of those things where you got to do everything that you can do to make sure that you just compete and make a total. And it was definitely one of the hardest experiences of my life. It was one of like the happiest and most fun, but also definitely the hardest.
And how's your wrist doing now?
It's all right. I have to get surgery on it to repair some stuff. And the shots that we did of cortisone kind of stopped everything from healing. So we got to kind of suck that stuff back out. It's not a good healthy thing to do to put cortisone into a spot, especially how much we put in.
And your body's already been ravaged by a decade of football. Your knees I've read you have arthritis in your knees from football.
Yeah, actually, I just spent about 2 hours in the MRI machine checking my knees and my shoulder. And they're all banged up. I have arthritis in both knees. I have a couple cysts and some bone spurs and other things like that. But luckily, no distinct tears. So other than the ones that I already had. So it's, you know, they're kind of banged up, but they're not terrible. I've been very fortunate not to have like an ACL tear or an MCL or like any of the major things. I haven't really torn. Mine's more wear and tear kind of thing. I got to knock on wood on that one, but I haven't done any of that yet. So that's good.
I'm going to cover some of the topics that seem to be like recurring themes in the interviews that you've done before. Like one thing that comes up a lot is your brother. Obviously he's an NFL lineman and in your MTV, what's that show called? Crap.
True Life.
And when you were in True Life, it goes into your relationship with him and the competition between them. So I guess one thing I want to know about your competition with them is between the two of you, which one of you does your parents love more?
Well, obviously it's me.
Okay. Okay. So,
honestly, I think my parents love our little sister probably more than everyone. So I'm going to say that's the way it goes on that one.
It is. I'm the baby of the family. So that's usually how it works.
It's not fair. I used to be the baby of the family until she came along. Wasn't too happy about that, but I think she's the favorite now.
So if your brother makes it to the Super Bowl, will you wait until the last minute and then head out?
Probably. I'm going to probably wait and then tell him on Twitter that I need a ticket. Probably the night before. Be like, hey, I need a ticket, so if you could facilitate that, that'd be great.
I think it's got to be hard for you as an athlete to constantly be compared to your brother and be, you know, there were so many headlines I saw where you were breaking out of the shadow of your brother. And in your own right, you are an amazing athlete. Is that hard to have to constantly refer back to him?
I always answer those questions with, I've never really looked at it as being in my brother's shadow. I feel like I was blessed enough to have a brother that kind of paved the way for me. I do know that my story is definitely more noticeable and notable because of my brother. And I think that it's something that just defines us as a family. I've never really thought like I was in his shadow or had to follow his footsteps. I kind of enjoyed it. It got me to go to, when I was at Ohio State camp with him, he would drop me off there and everybody would be like, ooh, that's your brother. And I'd be like, yeah, that's my bro. So, you know, it was a cool thing. It wasn't really a shadow. And it is kind of, it's funny how everyone kept asking me in every interview was like, how excited were you that your brother came all the way out here? And I was like, well, I was excited that he came out here, but I was really excited for like the 16 other family members that dropped everything and came out too, you know? So kind of frustrating that aspect where you got someone like my sister who's like scraping her pennies together to come out to London and they're like, isn't it great that your brother came out? And I'm like, yeah, it's great he came out, but it's great my whole family came out. I'm just happy everybody could get there.
Yeah, I think your brother could afford a plane ticket.
Maybe. I mean, he's gonna have to save for a couple months, but I think he's got to do that.
Well, I think the one thing I noticed was that is that you talk a lot about your brother and your dad's high expectations for you, and how they kind of they and in fact the expectations for you from them wasn't so much that you would do the just be good, that you would be expected to perform on a whole other level than the other guys on your team, talking about football. How did that help motivate you? How did their expectations kind of mold you?
I think it instilled kind of like a drive to be the best, or at least strive to be the best. It's that really competitive nature. It's that my dad and my brother used to always say, if you're going to do this, you need to be better than, you can't just be as good as everybody else. You have to be better than them. And then everybody will be okay with it. So I think that kind of instilled in me this drive that I always have to be really good, no matter what I'm doing. So whether it's athletics, I want to be the best. Whether it's when I was in college, it was my, field of what I was trying to learn. I wanted to be the best. I was that like really annoying kid in class that would answer the question every time because I wanted to be like, ha ha, I got it. I'm the best. It's kind of like creepy how much I want to do that, but it's very relevant in a lot of things. And my best friend actually sometimes just when we're arguing, she just goes, you win, you win, you got it. Just to shut me up because she knows that I'm just trying to, sometimes I get a little overboard with it, but I try to keep it in check.
A lot of things in your interviews that people bring up to you, so I don't want to like influence your answer, but some things that have recurred throughout your life, from what I've read, is the fact that you were the only girl on the team, and the fact that you were heavier and on the team, and the fact that your dad and brother had these expectations for you. Which of those was kind of the prime motivator? Was one more important in you trying to prove that you were the best, or was it just you were you and you were trying to be the best?
I think it was just I was me and I was trying to be the best. And I think it was no matter what, I wanted that. Whether it was because I was the only girl. Hold on one second. Something crazy is going on out there. No, it's one of my roommates scurrying around. Could you ask that question again? I'm like a goldfish. I forgot about it.
Well, it seems like for some people that being the only woman on a football team, you'd want to prove that as a woman you can be as good as the men, if not better. Same thing with being heavier, that you might want to prove that as a fat person you can still kick ass. And then having the expectations of your dad and brother. Was it just you? Was it just you striving to be the best, or was it something else?
I think it was just me striving to be the best, but I definitely have those tendencies. Like I remember playing football, sometimes I'd try to be really manly just to show them that I belonged. So I would do stuff that really isn't something women should do. I would just be like really manly and just to show them that I could and I could be just as gross as they could. And then, definitely with being a larger person, sometimes I just want to run over and do a box jump so people know that I can. But then I was definitely like that in high school. And I think now it's like I don't care. You could look at me and think that I'm not an athlete and I'm not going to try to prove myself to you. It's this whole new change of I don't really care. Like I know I'm comfortable with who I am. You are who you are and people are going to think things no matter what. I mean, the worst thing about it is whether you're extremely fat, people are going to think you're lazy. When people are extremely skinny, they're gonna think they're anorexic. When they're people, when you're extremes of a spectrum, people are just gonna assume things, and there's no changing their opinion.
That's cool that you have come to a place of acceptance where you don't have to like justify like, hey, I'm an Olympian. But the story that I read of you going to the bank and the woman laughing in your face, did you crush her? Did you just take her skull and no, nothing?
Even correct her.
No?
Yeah, because it doesn't really matter. It was really funny. She was like, oh, seriously, so family's out there? What are you visiting? I was like, Yep. I was like, yep, can't wait to get out there. Finished up what I was doing and I was out. You know, it was just, it's one of those things where it was like, I don't really care. It was more of a, this is so funny. Like, this would only happen to me. So I mean, it was a funny experience, and it's actually something really funny to talk about.
I would, you know, because you know the truth. Who cares what she thinks, you know?
Right.
But you, for the record, and I learned this, I did a thing where we gathered up all the photos of Olympians, and I found over 100 Olympians who do not look like you kind of associate with the Olympics. There's over 100 of them that look like, if you saw them on the street, you would go, you're not an Olympian, you're just a fat guy. But for the record, you are not the heaviest Olympian. There's,
you know, I heard that. I heard there was a woman that was actually heavier than me. She was from judo.
There's a guy, Ricardo Blas Jr., is 528 pounds, something like that.
That's what I'm talking about, see? I'm small compared to that. I'm slim. Trim.
So what do you think? Am I buff or what? Am I blue, twisted, cold, rolled steel or what?
Are you sure you've lifted already? You're not planning to lift at some future date or anything?
No.
Nope. I see it. Your arm goes along and then there's a little bump there.
No, there's this little ripped bicep is what you mean. Poindexter Crow, you're gone. No more the pathetic weenie to be pushed around at will.
Yeah, great. Hey, Cambot, why don't you zoom in with a macro lens? Maybe we can get a shot of that.
You don't need no macro lens, Nelson. I am superbly buff and that's that.
Hey, Mike, could I get a spot over here, man?
Servo, you're,
Yeah, I know. I've got 8 arms and a colossal tuckus, and all this from one leg press. I am quite susceptible to bulking up.
Well, maybe you've done enough for one day, then.
Yeah, probably, but I'm addicted now. If I don't lift, I die. So if I could get a spot over here?
Yeah, sure, no problem, man. Hey, man. First, I gotta talk to Pearl, though.
No. All right.
See, I was going for tone.
So, one other question I had about being the heaviest female weightlifter, do your boobs ever get in the way? Are they ever a problem?
No, they don't. Well, I'm not going to say that. I have hit them once or twice, but that's my own fault. I mean, you could be a tiny girl with the biggest boobs in the world, and you could still figure it out. Sure, you'd probably have to strap them down, but they never get in the way. I'm sure my stomach would probably get in the way before my boobs did. Even though my boobs do stick out over my stomach, it's just, it's one of those things, by the time it's here, your arm is going out like that, gonna be around it. Like, you physically, my elbow.
There was one photo I saw, and it was like a still of you as you were jerking. And it looks like your boobs are just attacking you. It looks like you are under assault.
Yes. Yes, that happens every day. They obviously don't like me. It doesn't matter how strong of a sports bra I get, they still hit me in the chin every time I do a lift. So that's something I just have to get used to.
So speaking of boobs, I've been waiting to ask this question since I started asking you if I could do an interview with you.
Mm-hmm.
The Olympic Village.
Do you have to, you're like haunting me right now.
Just totally subconscious. Totally subconscious I was doing this.
Nice.
Olympic Village, Roman orgy or Greek orgy? What was it?
It is a fun place for athletes to be, and athletes should keep that between athletes.
What happens in the Olympic Village stays in the Olympic Village.
Pretty much.
I was hoping for some juicy details of, you know, judo on judo action or something. I don't know.
Not so. One bit. Mm-mm. Not lady. This is what I've been telling people when they ask me that. When you make it to the Olympics, you can find out if it's true or not.
Well, then I'm screwed. Okay.
You never know.
Yeah.
It's too late.
There could be one for Olympic napping, because that's the only thing I'm going to get in. The thing that amazes me about you as an athlete, and setting aside all these assumptions people make about you just looking at you, you are doing 27 hours a week of training. How does your body even sustain that level of training? How do you even, like, get up in the morning and say, I'm going to do this again?
You know, it's one of those things that people laugh at me when I say that I actually do have a good diet. I just eat a ton. So that good diet is what gets me keep moving. You know, it's something that you can't do the kind of the lifting and stuff that I'm doing, eating cheeseburgers every day. I've been eating really, really bad since I got back from the Olympics because I can. And I was like, I'm going to eat this cheeseburger because I can. And nobody can say anything about it. You know, like, I don't care. And so I've been eating terrible. I've been eating French fries and pasta, and I've been eating bread. I haven't eaten bread in forever. I've been eating all kinds of stuff. And I honestly don't even want to walk to the kitchen. Like, I feel so weighed down and gross. And it's funny, one of those things where it's a fun treat, but eating like this, you know, thank God for weightlifting, because otherwise I'm pretty sure I'd be 800 pounds because, you know, I could just eat for days. But it's just, that's what keeps you going, is having that strict schedule of, I really tried hard not to eat a lot of bread before I compete. I try to have a lot of protein, and, you know, I eat a lot of Chipotle. I feel like that's good for me. So that maybe Chipotle has a secret spice in there that keeps you going, because, you know, I keep eating that. And
I see a sponsorship. I see a sponsorship in 2016.
Yeah, that'd be nice. That or City Barbecue is the other thing that I eat probably 24/7. That's a barbecue joint here in Ohio, and it's amazing. And all I eat is brisket.
It's the one you work for.
Yeah. And so that would make sense why I eat it 24/7. But it's also doing ice baths, icing, you know, trying to get to the chiropractor when I can, you know, just keeping my body aligned, keeping everything together. And it's just trying to really keep, like, really take care of your body.
Well, it's, I think that your story, your life that you are living as an Olympic athlete, is kind of the traditional, like, what you hear of, like, what kind of what you think when you hear Olympic athlete, somebody who is not getting millions of dollars in endorsements and that's their full-time job. You're working at a barbecue place while you're training. That's amazing. That is what the Olympic spirit to me is. Like, you're doing this for the love of the sport.
Yeah, it definitely is. You have to love this sport to be able to do it as full-time like I do it. And one of the big things that I'm all about is being self-sufficient. I'm such a nomad. Even if I had money, I'd still probably live in someone's laundry room. That's just who I am. I like minimal stuff. I like to just be able to pick up and go whenever I want to. And honestly, I think this sports allows you to do that. I mean, I could pick up and go and live on someone's couch for like 3 months and be completely happy with it. You know, it's just, it's one of those things, and I think that's what the Olympics is all about, living in those conditions that aren't really what everybody talks about when they talk about professional athletes. You think of these mansions and all of these great things. Well, then you've got athletes like me who are willing to sleep on a couch if we get a good coach. You know, it's kind of that balance.
So I guess I have some questions about the sport itself. The men's heavyweight is 105 kilograms, 230 pounds. For us lazy Americans who can't convert.
Right.
Women's heavyweight is 75 kilograms or 165 pounds. And that's kind of like...
When I competed at the Olympics, I was 156 kilos, which is, it's like 340.
So you're like significant, and I wrestled in high school, and that was a big thing, is that weight differential. There was a top end to the weight in wrestling in high school. So do you think that women's weightlifting should have more weight classes so that it's not nearly so, like...
I definitely think there should be. I think when they first created the weight classes for women, they didn't really think there was going to be a lot of women that were as huge as some of the women are. I was the heaviest woman in weightlifting, but most of the women in my class are around 120 to 130. There's a couple at the 100s, but you never have anyone below, like, 100 kilos or 90 some kilos in the 75 plus class. So I definitely think there needs to be more. There should definitely be somewhere in the 80s for women. There should be somewhere probably in the 90s, and then maybe do it like men have a 105 plus or whatever. I think it would be better for some of the women that are in betweeners. I mean, if you weigh 80 kilos, you're kind of screwed. If you can't lose it, you got to gain like 10, 15 more kilos just to be competitive. So definitely need more weight classes.
What's the advantage of being heavier in weightlifting?
In any weight class, it's an advantage of being as heavy as you can in that weight class. So let's say you're a 63 kilo girl. You want to be 62.9 kilos if you can. You'd like to be 60, like, I think it's 63 plus. Yeah, so 62.99 or whatever, because it gives you more mass. It gives you, with me, one of my advantages I've had is I have so much mass, the bar literally wraps around me. I don't really, I've been able to cheat on a lot of things where I don't really have to use as much core as other people because I have so much mass pushing mass. Once I started getting into those heavier weights, though, I could no longer cheat. I had to use my core and find out new technique ways. But it is a definite advantage. And it's an advantage if you're a clean athlete, being heavier, because you can pack on more fat to pack on that muscle. It's very hard to have a high muscle mass and very low body fat. So you see a girl with like 3% body fat and she looks ripped. Something very unnatural about that. Something's very wrong.
Well, and while we're on that subject, you were on Rachel Ray and had your body fat analyzed.
Mm-hmm. So I was 5'8 and 320 at the time. And the girl that was with me was 5'10 and 120. And I had 37% body fat and she had 33% body fat. And that's a 200-pound difference and only like 4% body fat difference.
So you're just like, it's just packed on you.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. There are times, like when I jump up to 350, I've got more fat than I should, and my body fat percentage probably goes up. But when I'm around 320, 300, it's crazy how much my body fat drops. They said if you stripped all the fat off me right now, I'd still weigh 210. So it's, you know, it's just, I got a lot of fat, but I got a lot of muscle. It's good mixture of both.
I think you are crushing stereotypes left and right. I mean, really, it was so nice to finally have somebody in the Olympics that I was like, I want to see this person succeed. I want to follow them. I want to see what they do.
Oh, that's nice. I wish I could have succeeded for you.
No, you did. You weren't even supposed to be there.
I know. I could have done so much more. It was kind of crushing when I got hurt. It definitely hurt.
You are such an asshole for getting hurt. I mean, really, you could. America is really disappointed in you.
I was just being a dick. I just
did it on purpose. Pretty selfish.
Yeah, it's selfish.
Just think about every good sports movie, every good like biopic of, there I go again, every good sports movie needs boobs. Every good athlete biopic needs, you know, you start out and you go as far as you can and then you don't quite make it and then you go back and you reach your glory. So that's, you've got 4 years to reach your glory.
I'm just writing the story. I mean, it's funny because this is the beginning. I mean, this is the beginning of the beginning. You know, I have so much more to do in this sport before I leave it. So it's kind of exciting that I was able to go to the Olympics. And I feel like the next Olympics I go to will be like old hat. I've already been there.
You know, when you started out weightlifting 3.5 years ago, you won your first junior national in 2008. And that was really, you hadn't done it very long. And you did it by like brute strength. You were just incredibly strong. And you lifted 407 pounds or 185 kilos for you Europeans. And this last go round with the Olympics, you hit your personal record of 255 kilos or 562 pounds. And mm-hmm. largely from what I understand, that was because you refined your technique and you improved your technique. And I would imagine just working out relentlessly. What I'm wondering is Lulu Zhao, she totaled 734 pounds.
Yes.
That's almost like 180 pounds more than you.
Did we also check to see if she was female?
I gotta tell you that I read that a lot. People questioning her gender.
I never want to judge anyone, but that person I may be judging.
Well, can you bridge that gap in the next 4 years, do you think? Is that going to be your goal, or are you just going to set your own goals?
Honestly, this next Olympics, my goal is to total 300, which would not be what they totaled. It would be a bronze, but that's my goal. I'd be the first woman in America to total 300. It would be all this great. You know, I got to work on me. I can't worry about what the competition is doing.
Yeah.
Now, honestly, I think the people that are cheating and doping will get, hopefully, they'll meet their end that they should have.
And what is that end? What end would you recommend for the dopers?
Well, no. Getting out of the sport. That's what I recommend. Okay. It should be a lifetime ban. It should be, if you are caught doing something, you should be banned for life. Coming up just like a lion. Pump it up.
Faith in Blast Hard Cheese.
Flint Iron Stag.
Bolt Vanderhuge.
Buck Plank Chest.
Stump Junkman.
Dirk Hardpeck.
Rip Steak Face.
Blast Thick Neck.
Crunch Butt Steak.
Slab Squat Thrust. Big McLarge Huge.
Blake Fist Crunch.
Buff Hardback.
Bob Johnson.
Oh, wait.
Let's get out there! Kick the back!
Trunk Slam Chest.
Fist Rock Bone.
Stump Beef Knob.
Smash Lamp Jaw. Well, anyway, got that out of my system.
Roll Fizzle Beef.
Hotchka!
Hotchka, of course.